Server-side request forgery is today's topic. And in order to start off, I thought to show you a list of URLs. Each one of them that you can see here on the screen is basically an attack payload that might be leveraged during a server-side request forgery attack. And this video is going to cover this all in detail. Let's get started. What is a server-side request forgery? I thought to come up with a definition in a simple sentence before we're gonna go to a more graphical explanation. A server-side request forgery is an attack where a vulnerable service takes untrusted user input and creates a new request based on that input, allowing an attacker to control where the service connects to. So there's a couple of pieces to kind of dive into in this definition. Let's look at that. Let's assume we have a web application and it is like a server and has an endpoint which is assets. So this is our service. And in order to kind of leverage the service, right, we have query parameters and it can do various things based on the query parameters. And this is sort of our untrusted input in this case. So we have a vulnerable service, a web server, for instance, and then we have a query parameter or any form of other variable or user-controlled data that an attacker might modify, and that then exploits the service. This has a wide-reaching, it can have wide-reaching implications, right? If an attacker modifies that untrusted user input, if it's leveraged insecurely, they can access internal information, they can bypass firewall restrictions, perform like internal port scanning, and in the worst case, it can be denial of service or even remote code execution. And we're going to talk about remote code execution in this video. Let's look at the more graphical explanation. So we have a server here on the right, and you know it's based in a data center or in an Amazon VPC, and there's a set of other services it connects to or talks to, other machines in the environment, a database server, some other nodes, and so on. And we have the user on the left, and the user wants to leverage this application. So as part of using the application, they might create a web request that downloads a picture. And following that example from earlier, it is a web server, right, has an assets endpoint, and then the location, they provide the location from where the file is to be downloaded. So the request is issued, the server sees it, it modifies it, it creates a separate request internally. This is like a new request, retrieves the image, and sends it back to the user. And everybody is happy. So now let's enter Mallory, because Mallory is going to use the server differently. So it's the same endpoint, but look how Mallory modified it. It's now pointing to another server in the internal network, 192.168.0.1. So what happens when this request is issued? The server is going to do the same thing. It's going to create a new request, but now it actually, because it's vulnerable to server-side request forgery, it is issuing this request to this other machine in the environment and accessing a document and downloading that document and serving it to the attacker. This is what a server-side request forgery is. There's variations of this attack. There's actually many variations, and this is what we're going to walk through now in more detail. So first variation is the attacker might also host their own attack server. And the goal is that they have the server infrastructure of this web server connect to the attacker machine. This will allow them to pull off other attacks. Same scenario, now look at the URL, it's attacker/malware, the server is vulnerable to server-side request forgery, creating the separate request to pull the resource, and now they're going to connect to the attacker server, and Mallory controlling that server can serve anything she wants to this other server. This might be, you know, malware that or other files that get stored in the machine for later use. It might be a denial of service attack by sending down gigabytes of data or performing a trickle attack. This exploits the server. So we looked through these two examples now, and now let's look into all the other variations of this attack. So the first one, the very obvious one, is attacking the local host. An attacker might always attempt to access a different port. So if there's a local web server running that doesn't have authentication and it's just listening on a different port, a server-side request forgery can access that and issue commands to it. The next scenario is that we can leverage different protocols. So you might be able to issue file system commands and read files from the file system like etc password, or connect to a Windows server, download documents from a machine there. The attacker might download files from their own infrastructure. We talked about that already. A really interesting one is cloud metadata services that are accessible from the machine typically. So if you are in a virtual machine in the cloud, there's often, for instance, in Amazon EC2, there's this local endpoint you can connect to that gives you information about your service, including the credentials that this account is running under. And so with server-side request forgery, an attacker might be able to access those credentials. The really interesting one is remote code execution. And here's an example, for instance, where an attacker might issue a local command to an internal server and then execute the log4j exploit, which by itself technically is sort of a server-side request forgery also. And that then leads to remote code execution. Very interesting one, this one. Another example is redirects that can be leveraged in case there's like a problem with time of check versus time of use that the server has. So an attacker might be able to perform a redirect and then, for instance, redirect to localhost or to an external server even, depending on which ones are allowed, and then gain access that way. This is kind of similar to DNS rebinding attacks, if you think about it. The next scenario is leaking authentication tokens and credentials. There's two scenarios that I have experienced. One is where the attacker is just pointing to the attacker server and the server is just giving credentials away by doing the request, right? They might just automatically attend your bearer token and then that bearer token is sent out to the attacker. The other scenario is SMB scenarios where if you use the file system scheme and you connect to an SMB server, the server might attach the net and TLM hash, which then the attacker could capture and crack. So this is a very powerful attack. We talked about denial of service briefly already. So this is another scenario to be worried about, is that an attacker can perform denial of service attacks with server-side request forgery. And to be aware is also that IP addresses themselves can be written in different notations. So you don't have to use the dot notation. You can just use integers or octets or just leverage IPv6, which might also be allowed. So these are kind of common scenarios to be aware of, right? We talked about basically you can perform port scanning, denial of service attacks, reading other documents, invoking APIs in the internal network, and so on. It's really scary attack avenue. So let's talk about mitigations. There's three high-level things that come to mind, which is always having an allow list for servers to connect to. Similar with ports, always have an allow list of ports where to connect to, and explicitly define ports and protocol. And the last thing that comes to mind is leveraging outbound firewall rules to kind of block or mitigate any sort of unwanted outbound connections. That's it. So here again, the list of possible attacks that sort of highlights a little bit some of these variations. There's a lot more scenarios that might be explored depending on how the server is implemented, what technology is implemented. For instance, if you have PHP, there's a couple of interesting scenarios, including the SIP protocol, for instance. Tell me a little bit about if you ever had exploited server-side request forgery yourself, possibly, or what scenarios you have run into. Thanks for watching.